What's up, everyone? Peekaboo here, and today we have a special kind of video. I've gotten a lot of questions recently since the new expansion's come out. Just kind of simple questions such as, you know, what's my stat priority? What legendary should I be using? What covenant should I be going? What should my conduits look like? All sorts of kind of things like that. What's my talent setup? And today, this has been a highly requested thing. We're finally going to try to make a YouTube video around it. This is my first time trying to do something like this. So if you do like this video, make sure you leave a comment, like it, subscribe, hit that bell notification, and all that good stuff. It'd be very highly appreciated. So I've never done this before, so we're going to try to figure out here and see kind of what exactly it looks like. I already re-recorded the intro about 30 times, and I didn't make a script, so we're just going to go off the top and just kind of see where we end up with that. So, to start it off here, right now, rogues are coming off the nerf, okay? They're not as good as they were before, but they're still somewhat viable. So, first things first, we're going to start with our spec. First of all, our specialization here. The only viable option right now, I think, to be playing in Arena is going to be Subtlety. If you're playing any of the other specs, such as a Sass or Outlaw, your best bet is to right now open your talent tree, hit this, and hit this, and forget it, okay? Stop playing anything else. We got to go sub right now. I don't think the other ones, like I said, I haven't fought any other rogues playing it. I've tried it myself. I can't make it work at all. I don't know. Maybe my gear is not that great, but right now, sub is definitely the way to go. So make sure you're spec to sub. So most of the information that's going to be in this video is going to revolve solely around this specialization. So to start it off here, we're going to go into our gear because one of the main questions is, okay, I see we're playing sub. And what does that mean? So what stats do I need to have for my rogue to do the most damage and, you know, make sure I'm winning the most games? So to put it simply here, the main stat priority you want to have for a rogue right now is you want to go agility, which is your main stat right here, and then versatility and mastery. Stacking versatility and mastery will give you the most overall damage output in the arena. So versatility increases all damage done, while mastery only increases your finishing move damage. So mastery means your eviscerates, your ruptures, and versatility means, you know, your auto attacks, your backstabs, your shadow strikes, your Kyrian spell, everything, right? So versatility and mastery, that's absolutely the stat priority. And I think I would always prioritize eye level over secondary stats, because right now my eye level is 204, and that's kind of low on the higher end compared to most other players at kind of the ratings that I'm playing at. So I'd say eye level is always better, but at the end of the day, you always want to go versatility and mastery for sub-roguing PvP. Now, so basically, you can get a lot of your gear too from a mix of either PvP, whether it's Battlegrounds or Arenas, Mythic Plus, or Raiding. And I think the overall best way to do it is to kind of have a combination of everything. But you could also just solely gear through PvP if you wanted to, or solely do PvE and also still do that as well. But I think having that mix at the end of the day is good because not all PvP pieces for a rogue will have Verse Mastery on them. And same with PvE. So not all PvE pieces will have Verse Mastery either. So that's why having a mix is kind of the best at the end of the day. So that's kind of the main stat priority for sub rogue and the gearing. And then the next part of that gearing is, I guess another controversial point is, when you're playing sub rogue, you only need to have a dagger in your main hand. It does not matter what your offhand is, which is why you see most sub rogues, they'll have the super high eye level dagger, but in the offhand, they use a mace or something because the secondary stats, that verse mastery, would actually outweigh the benefits of using, say, this 190 dagger that has haste verse on it. So certain little things like that are kind of minor. There's really no damage loss in using and not using two daggers as a sub rogue. And I think you actually get a transmog benefit too, as you can tell, because my character obviously is looking amazing. So that's what's going on. So yeah, that's why everyone uses that mace as well, just to kind of clear that up. So moving on to the next part of gearing here, we're going to go into the legendaries. You know, the legendaries are very, very important. So the legendary that I've always used is I've been using the Master Assassin legendary since day one. For me, it feels like when I'm playing sub rogue and a lot of the games that I'm in, all my damage comes from when I'm coming out of stealth. That first 4 seconds in the opener is generally where all the burst damage comes from. And having this legendary just means that every single reset you get, you're going to be super, super effective. So it's much easier to utilize this legendary in twos, which is why you see a lot more sub rogues kind of a you know, running rampant in twos compared to threes, because in threes, it's much harder to get restealths and get resets. But having this legendary makes it so any restealth you do get is always super high value. So if we look at some of the other legendary powers here that people like to run with, a lot of the ones that you might see a lot of other rogues using are this one, where your vanish reduces the cooldown of all your other spells by 20 seconds. This is another popular option. I personally don't like this one. I haven't really played much with it, but I've just seen other people play with it, and I just feel like the Master Assassin gives you so much damage that it's really hard to pass up on, especially now when you fight kind of tankier compositions. It's really difficult to land kills, and this helps you so much. So this is why I always go with the Master Assassin. And Ed, put this in, Akari's is trash. Don't ever use Akari's ever. It's just not good, and I would never recommend it ever. It's super, it just does no damage. Because try to Shadow Strike a Warrior or a Paladin, and when you're hitting for 1,000, your Akari's is hitting for, you know, 25% of that. So it's terrible. So another question people ask is, you know, why do you craft it on the Bracer instead of the Ring? And honestly, I thought it mattered at first, but as time has gone on, it doesn't really matter which piece you craft it on. Just make sure you upgrade it, and just make sure you're stacking the Verse Mastery stats. One last question on gear before we move on is the trinkets. So I actually have the Skulker's Wing, the Heroic Trinket, and this does a lot of instant damage. It's kind of similar to the Dressigoth from last expansion. And this is very, very good in twos because it's good versus leather and cloth and mail, but it's not very good versus plate classes. And in threes, I generally opt to not use this because it's super hard to hit the right target. A lot of the times it misses or it just bugs out. So your next best option is to go with the PvP trinket. So using two PvP trinkets is super, super valuable right now because if we can read the set bonus, it says the damage and healing benefit of versatility is increased by 40% when you're actually in any PvP environment. So this would basically mean my 23% damage increase, I get another, you know, 10 to 11% damage increase or so. So just flat across the board is really, really good. And also the on use is kind of nice too. So if you can use the Skulker's Wing, use it in twos, not so much in threes, but overall, this is always a great, great pick. You can never go wrong with the double PvP trinket setup. So that's what I'd recommend on gearing. The next part of that is we'll go into our talent tree. So I see a lot of people always kind of talking all about the talents and all this stuff like this. So when I'm playing Sub Rogue, I use two different talent builds. I use one for 2v2 and one for 3v3. So the one I'm showing you right now, this is for 2v2. So I'll just go through the talent tree and kind of explain it and break it down, and then we'll go to the all new talents here. So in the first tree, we have the only viable options are Weapon Master or Premeditation. Gloomblade is virtually useless. It's really, really bad because as it replaces Backstab. And I'm sure any Sub Rogue player out there, if you've noticed, Backstab literally does zero damage. It's like the worst spell ever. The only time you ever hit Backstab is if you can't Shadow Strike. So it shouldn't be that often. And you're never going to kill anyone because you're backstabbing them. So this is totally out of the question. It's garbage. So don't ever go Gloomblade. So Weapon Master, there's a potential argument for Weapon Master. But the thing is, a 15% chance to do extra damage is pretty fried. It's pretty low and it's really random. And this, like I said, this would share synergy with the Akari's Legendary, which I said you should never use because it's totally useless in threes. Do not use it. Not good in twos unless you're trying to do this crazy cheesy one-shot build. But this is just how I play, so I'm going to explain it, and it's not good. So I run with Premeditation because this makes it much easier to build combo points because what actually kills people in Arena is your Eviscerates, not the Shadow Strikes. So anytime you get a re-stealth, you're guaranteed getting a stronger opener because of the extra combo points, and this is simultaneously putting up Slice and Dice so you don't have to waste any combo points actually pressing Slice and Dice because Slice and Dice is one of the worst spells in the game. It's totally useless. There's a big meme out there that pressing Slice and Dice is good. You should literally never hit Slice and Dice ever. The only time I hit Slice and Dice is if I'm in stealth and I have some combo points to spare and I'm trying to activate my Recuperator Conduit, which I'll talk about conduits later. So Premeditation, always the go-to. Stronger openers, works on every single Shadow Strike on your first, the first Shadow Strike in Shadow Dance, the first one coming out of stealth, and the first one coming out of Vanish. So that's the times that you apply this, and that's why your Slice and Dice is also activated for a big majority of the game just by having this talent. So you don't have to waste any combo points on Slice and Dice. Next talent sheet for twos, I always opt to go for Night Stalker. Shadow Focus is really bad in PvP. It's only good in PvE. So don't ever take Shadow Focus ever. So Night Stalker in twos, because in twos, like I said, a lot of the burst damage comes really, really quick and early. And especially when you have those Master Assassin's Bracers, you combine it with the crit chance. And it's much easier to utilize this talent in twos because there's not as many targets to CC and not as many people that can hit you out of stealth. So always go Night Stalker in twos. Talking in 3v3, I generally always opt to go for Subterfuge because when you are playing threes as the sub rogue, your job is to be stunning multiple targets, you know, CCing multiple targets and locking people down. And having that Subterfuge makes it much, much easier, especially if you get knocked out of stealth. That's one of the downsides of Night Stalker. If you're knocked out of stealth, you have to instantly Shadow Dance or something because you can't use any of your abilities that require stealth. So Subterfuge is kind of a nice little cushion if you do get AoE'd out or get found or something like that you can still kind of get somewhat of a decent opener. So Subterfuge, really, really good in threes, especially if you're trying to stun multiple targets. Like I said, maybe in threes, you want to sap a target, you want to sap the healer, and then stun the DPS, and then open on the other DPS, right? So that's why Subterfuge is good. But in twos, you don't need to do that. In twos, there's just usually a healer and DPS, so you just sap the healer and open on the DPS, so you don't really need Subterfuge at that point, right? Because you'd still be in stealth after the first sap, so Subterfuge is good for CCing multiple targets. Night Stalker just gives you a little more burst damage. That's kind of the main differences between the two. And never Shadow Focus. Ever. It's terrible. Okay, next row. This one, there's also only one viable option. It's always marked for death every single time. It's been marked for death for a very long time, and it's still marked for death to this day. Deeper Stratagem, also PvE talent only. It's never good. It's so hard to even build 6 combo points in PvP. And this literally only works if you can just literally attack a target forever, and it's really not efficient or effective, and the damage you get is totally not worth it. And the Kidney Shot duration increase, no. It's marked for death every time. And then this one, Vigor, is also completely useless. Having 50 extra energy and the energy regen literally does nothing for sub rogue. It really doesn't do anything at all. So you never go for this. The reason why Marked for Death is so good is because it gives you the potential to either instantly 5-point kidney shot someone, because what Marked for Death does is it gives you 5 calm points on a target on a 30-second cooldown, which is huge. So that's either a Marked for Death instant kidney shot, or it's a Marked for Death eviscerate. So those things right there are super, super powerful, because most of your burst damage while playing sub rogue comes from your big double eviscerate, which is your 5-point eviscerate, Marked for Death, another 5-point eviscerate, and that's when people start dying. Or it's the clutch kidney shot to on the hero to win the game, or the clutch kidney shot on the kill target so they can't get away, and things like that. So Marked for Death always, always, always is the option, and it's the most high value talent here. So in the next row, this is another row that that changes between twos and threes. In 2v2, I always opt for Soothing Darkness, because generally when I'm playing sub rogue, I'm always playing double DPS compositions, which means there's no healer. So when you're playing without a healer, you need some way to get health back. Otherwise, you're kind of just a glass cannon. If someone starts attacking you, there's a very high chance you're going to die immediately. So having this is a super big deal. So outside of arena, it's actually 3%, and it's nerfed in arena. So once you go into arena, it only heals you for 1% of your max health, but that's still a lot better than having no healing at all. So this is one of the main reasons why I'm even able to play so many twos the way I do, and why I pull off a lot of those crazy 1v2 situations, or win in most 1v1 situations. It's because of all the self-healing from this talent right here. So always in twos, Soothing Darkness. In threes, I generally always opt to go for Elusiveness, because in threes, you're not going to get that much value out of Soothing Darkness, because you're not going to re-stealth too much, you're not going to be sitting in stealth, and there's a lot more people that can attack you, and there's a lot more stuff going on. So you get much more value out of this in threes than you would in twos, since like I said, the healer makes the biggest difference. When you're playing with a healer, you go Elusiveness. When you're playing without a healer, you go Soothing Darkness. And then the oddball one is Cheat Death. I hate this talent. I've lost many games to people playing this. And whenever I play Cheat Death, I tend to die instantly through it anyway. So this is a really random talent. Sometimes it can save you versus super high burst damage compositions like Double Rogue or Mage Rogue, or like a Melee Cleave that just runs in and kills you. But honestly, you should never go Cheat Death. This is a pretty, it's kind of the noob friendly option. And I'm telling you, we're not trying to be noobs anymore. Okay, so it's either Elusiveness, so you gotta start fainting, or Soothing Darkness. So this is without a healer, and this is with a healer. I would not recommend playing Cheat Death. I don't think it's good. I don't think it's good. Even though I've lost to it, and it's super cheesy, it's not that consistent. We're looking for consistency, okay? We want consistent wins. We don't want to win once every 20 times. We want to win, like, you know, 15 plus out of 20 times. You know, look for those numbers, right? That's a pretty realistic option compared to the, you know, maybe get lucky one time, right? So this is much more consistent. We're looking for that right there. So, or ideally win every game, but you know, no one wins every game, okay? So, but yeah, the point is consistency is better than your random oddball chance of winning, okay? So that's what's going on. This tier, it's always, always, always Prey on the Weak. Prey on the Weak is so important for landing kills, and Subrogue already struggles with damage when they're outside of dance, or when they're under pressure, or people have used their cooldowns and you're trying to reset. So any extra damage you can get is going to be super, super important. So, and then not only does it increase your damage as the rogue player, but also everyone on your team that's attacking the target also gets that damage increase. It's nerfed to 5% in arena, but it's still better than the other options. Like Night Terror is useless because you have Crippling Poison, so there's no point to ever spec into this ever. Shot in the Dark I never play Shot in the Dark ever. I've seen sub rogues try it, but it's generally not worth it at the end of the day. I think that free you know, cheap shot is useless compared to the 5% damage increase. So I would never play Shot in the Dark ever. This row, I always opt to pick Enveloping Shadows. Enveloping Shadows is the best talent because it gives you an extra charge of Shadow Dance, because as we can see, if I spec into Dark Shadow, I only have one dance. If I go back to Enveloping, I've got two. So Dark Shadow, what it does is it says it gives you 30% damage increase when your Shadow Dance is up, but in PvP, it's actually nerfed to only 15%. Before, this is what all rogues used to play, but nowadays, it's actually much more viable to be spec'd into Enveloping Shadows because it's much more consistent. Nowadays, especially when you're playing WoW, a lot of the damage is based around your dance, and the whole spec is based around dance for the most part, because As you guys can probably tell, when you're playing it yourself or you fight other rogues, if they don't have Shadow Dance up, you're usually never going to die to them. So this makes it so if you open on someone and you use your first Shadow Dance and you get their defensive cooldowns and they're running away and you can't kill them, you still have a Shadow Dance available to still be aggressive and still be a force in the arena, because a rogue without dance is the worst thing ever. And this also, the second best part of this talent, not only that you get a whole nother Shadow Dance, is that your Shadow Dance also resets much faster than it would if you're specced into Dark Shadow. So this basically is just a much more consistent build. You lose a little bit of burst damage, but overall the damage you get from having that extra dance and the faster resets makes up for that lack in burst damage. So always developing shadows in both twos and threes. In the last tier here, there's really only one option. Again, they make this easy. Shuriken Tornado is totally useless. Shuriken Storm doesn't actually do damage. It's only used for building combo points. Secret Technique is a PvE specific talent. It's only good for AoEing. So this is never used in arena. And Master Shadows is always the way to go, because extra energy when you're spamming Shadow Dance is super, super important. So always goes that. So one last quick rundown. So for 2v2, this is what my talent tree looks like right here. Premeditation, Night Stalker, Mark for Death, Soothing Darkness, Prayer in the Weak, Enveloping, and Master Shadows. And in 3v3, I'll switch it to Subterfuge and Elusiveness. That's the only difference between my twos talents and threes talents. Moving over here to the honor talent section, these never change either. The first one I always run with, I always go with Cold Blood. This is just a free 10% damage, and there's really no better option. You can't. This just makes your dances just that much more powerful, and it goes through armor and stuff like that. So it's super, super good, especially when people have high HP. Maybe they have a lot of armor as well. This is always going to hit for 10%. Or at least, you know, give or take right around there, since it's affected by versatility. So 9 to 10% generally always. Very, very good. Next one is Shadowy Duel. As sub, I always run Shadowy Duel. I think this is it's a bit of a difficult talent to utilize, especially if you're new to the class. But I really think Shadowy Duel, every single sub rogue needs to be playing this. Basically, what it does is it makes it so the target you duel, that only you and them can see each other for the duration of the duel. So basically, like a way you would use this is, let's say I'm trying to kill someone and I got him at 30% and their healer is about to come out of CC. So if I duel the person I'm killing, the healer can no longer target them or heal them, and I can kill them in that 1v1 in that duel, in that 6-second duel. So that's how that is. Or let's say someone's running down my healer, a warrior's chasing down my healer, my healer's at 10% health and the warrior's about to execute him. Boom, I duel the warrior and they can no longer attack my healer, and you know, maybe we live and get away. So you can use it offensively, like I said in the first option, or defensively for the second option. Or you can use it to like extend a CC chain on a healer. Say a healer is coming out of a polymorph and there's no way we can get another resheep or something, so I'll just duel the healer and then the healer can't heal the DPS, right? So there's a lot of ways to use this spell. It's definitely got a lot of different interactions, so I think duel's a must-have. Next one, Smoke Bomb. Always Smoke Bomb. Smoke Bomb's super, super useful. There's so many good times where you can Smoke Bomb to secure kills or play defensively or force lots and lots of cooldowns solely by pressing this. And what Smoke Bomb does, for those that don't understand, is it drops a cloud of smoke, and it basically acts like a line of sight. So anyone standing in the Smoke Bomb cannot be targeted by any spells outside of the Smoke Bomb. So let's say I Smoke Bomb myself and a mage is casting a Greater Pyro. They can't cast Greater Pyro Blast into the Smoke Bomb on me. And it only affects enemy players, not your own players. So like if I bomb my teammates can all still heal them and we can target each other and see each other and everything like that. But on the enemy side, they can't do anything. So it's just basically another line of sight. So it's super, super good, super valuable. Lots of opportunities with this ability. Super cool spell that's been around for a long time. Some of the other options and talents that I see some people try to do is some people try to play Dagger in the Dark, and they'll either sacrifice their Shadowy Duel or Cold Blood for it. And Dagger in the Dark sucks. So this thing is never good because it's virtually impossible to stack, especially after the opener. And it's a super kind of gimmicky thing. And it only stacks up when you're in stealth, not based on your Shadow Dance. So you could potentially maybe get one really big opener, but that's about it. So I it's really inconsistent, and I would never recommend playing this. And I've never played Dagger in the Dark ever. I've tried it with a Weapon Master, Dagger in the Dark, and like an Akari's or something, but it's not consistent. Like I said, we're looking for consistency. We're not trying to, you know, get the oddball win over here and there, you know. Even though you could play the way if you want to, but we need those consistent wins. And these talents I'm showing you, this is what I've done for a very long time. I'm sure you've seen lots of other rogues do it as well, and it's definitely the most consistent build that will give you the best chance to win in any situation, whether you get a great start or a bad one. So that's just kind of a quick little talent overview there. And my gear sets, gear and talents done. Another huge question we get asked about on the channel, me personally, is what covenant did you go? You know, what covenant did you go? So what I've done and what I still am is I'm actually Kyrian. I've not seen any reason to switch. They did recently nerf Kyrian Covenant by nerfing the Echoing reprimand damage by a large amount, but regardless, some rogues decided to switch to Night Fae, and I still don't think Night Fae is better. I think Kyrian offers way too many good things. What Kyrian does offer you, for those that don't know, is I can summon a steward, and it gives me a potion called File of Serenity, and what this potion does, as you can tell, is it restores 20% health, and it removes all diseases, poisons, curses, and bleeds affecting you. So this is basically like a mini health stone in the arena. It also removes lots of great debuffs off you, potentially, so you get a clean re-stealth. It's really good defensively, and I think it's just really, really nice. And it also resets if you get out of combat. So same function as a Hellstone, just much better than a Hellstone. And the next thing you get is an ability called Echoing Reprimand. And basically what this does is it does instant damage to the target. It doesn't really do much damage. I think this mostly is better now because of what it does when you use it. So after using this, you're given, I think, 175 or 150 mastery in arena for, you know, like 6 to 10 seconds. So it's just nice for that little mastery buff for your eviscerate damage or rupture damage. And then also, when you use this Echoing Reprimand, it'll actually make one of your combo points light up blue. And if you use a finishing move with the exact amount of combo points where it's lit up, like let's say my third one's lit up, it's gonna have this blue like circle thing around it. So if I use a 3-point eviscerate, it would actually act as a 7-point finisher. So like I said, the ability to have that 7-point finishing move eviscerate combined with your Master Assassin Bracers, that's just a really big way of hitting someone super, super hard. So, and that's you know, a dream scenario. Another question too is like, when you do have this, you shouldn't really try super hard to get the 7-point finisher because it's kind of awkward with combo point generation and stuff like that. But if you can get it, good, but that takes a little more time to kind of figure out where your combo points are and where you are in the rotation to make really, really good use of that. But I think the defensive potion is really good, and the fact that you get the mastery is you know, good enough reason to not stick or to not switch from Kyrian. So that's what I do. And then looking at our conduits here, basically there's a couple options. Usually what people used to run was this thing called Reverberation, which increased your Echoing Reprimand damage. I don't run this anymore. I don't think it's good to use because Echoing does so little damage. Some people, even if you have an epic one, I would not recommend using this. Currently what I use this thing called Deeper Daggers right here. So I go down the left side here, and I'm only renowned 10. So, you know, this is all probably going to change when people get more renowned and maybe better conduits and stuff. But for now, this is what I do, and it works pretty well for me. So I go with Deeper Daggers, and basically what this does is it makes your eviscerate. Black Powder is useless. Don't ever press that in arena. It's good in PvE, not PvP. So how this works is, some people might not know this because they changed this recently in Shadowlands, is eviscerate increases your shadow damage dealt by 8.8%. So you might be wondering, what is rogue shadow damage? So in your eviscerate, when you eviscerate a target that has Fine Weakness on it, which is your armor pen from either shadow striking or cheap shotting someone, as you can tell, it's like that green buff that you see on enemies. I believe it looks like that green buff looks like this, Fine Weakness. So yeah, cheap shotting, shadow strike make it so you can bypass 30% of the enemy's armor. So when you eviscerate someone with that buff on them, which they pretty much have this buff on them like the whole time if you're playing sub, your eviscerate does another 50% damage of shadow. So that's why if you look at like a details or a damage tracker, you see eviscerate twice. That's what that is. So, and I thought that the 8.8% shadow damage would be overall more viable than a one-time use of echoing. Like, I'd get more damage because I do a lot more eviscerates than I would echoing in a game, right? So that's kind of my thought process behind that. And it also affects Shadow Blades, but Shadow Blades is, you know, it doesn't do too much damage, so not a big deal. But yeah, Deeper Daggers is probably the most value out of there, I think. And then on the Endurance Conduits, this is all I have for my Endurance Conduit. I use the Recuperator. There's another one called Cloaked in Shadows, where it basically, every time you re-stealth, you get a really big shield. And once you re-stealth with that conduit, you can't get knocked out by dots unless you have, as long as the shield's up. So I think Recuperator is an okay option, but I think Cloaked in Shadows is probably the best one. But unfortunately, I don't have that right now. So this feels good for me. It works for me. And this is why I also play Premeditation, because what this Recuperator does is anytime Slice Knights is up, you're going to get a passive heal, kind of like how old Recuperate worked way back in Kata. So It's just a nice little, like a hot you can put on yourself. So a little heal over time effect. And when you Shadow Strike, you get that premeditation. So it automatically activates your Slice and Dice. So you're just getting healing back along with your Sleeping Darkness. It makes you a bit tankier is what it is. So that's pretty much my go-to. That's just kind of a short and sweet little rogue guide. That's how I've been playing so far. I feel like I've had a pretty good amount of success with the build I've shown you. There'll probably be more ways to play soon, but for right now, this is kind of what I've been doing. This is what works for me. So, like I said, hopefully this helps you. If you have any questions or anything, you know, catch me on the live stream. I stream 7 days a week. I start around 4:30 to 5 p.m. PST every single day, and I'm there. So, you know, leave a comment, subscribe, hit the bell notification. Thank you all again. I've never done something like this, so this is exciting for me. I've been talking about how I want to get into YouTube more, and you know, leave some feedback on how to improve the video or how I could do things better or if I didn't explain something properly. And if you have any ideas on some other videos that you'd like me to kind of go in depth and break it down, let me know. For now, it's about 2 in the morning. Ed told me if I didn't record this that he'd quit the next day. So, Ed, I got it done. Solid as a rock. You know how we do it. But for now, GG's. And I will see you all on the stream tomorrow. All right. Peace.